Hello everybody, this is Dr. Christopher White, and in this video we're going to be doing exercise 6 from Interpreting Earth History by Ritter and Peterson. Okay, so exercise 6 begins on page 78. Now in this exercise we're going to be doing physical correlations. We're actually going to be linking up adjacent layers of rock and trying to work out what's been happening to them. So just like all the other exercises, obviously there's an objective box here in purple, and then we have a description of physical correlation, the processes used to do it, on pages 78, 79, and 80. So once again, please take some time, have a look, read the text, and it's going to make your life easier. Okay, so let's start. So part A. So part A requires you to use these four stratigraphic columns. Okay. Now I should point out at this point that exercise number 6 is a very mark heavy exercise. You'll get a lot of marks for this exercise. So it's a high value exercise, so please make sure you do it, and please make sure you do it well, because this is worth more than some of the other exercises. Not all exercises are created equal. Alright, so the first thing we're going to do is we are going to construct lines of lithostratigraphic equivalence between the four sections. Okay, so we're going to link section 1 to section 2, section 2 to section 3, and section 3 to section 4. So the obvious question is how do we do that? Well, we're going to need a ruler and a pencil. So what you can see is we have the same layers of rock, Navajo sandstone, for instance, here, occurring in adjacent columns. Okay, and so what we're going to do is we are going to produce a line of lithostratigraphic correlation between the two. So here's the bottom of the Navajo sandstone here, and here's the bottom of the Navajo sandstone here. So what we can do is we can take our pencil and we can draw a line linking the two together. There's the top. There's the top. Once again, we can take our ruler, we can draw a line, and we can link the two together. And there we go. We have correlated between those two layers of rock at location 1 and location 2. Now, one of the things you are going to notice, though, is that sometimes a layer of rock that will occur in one column will not occur in the adjacent column. So let's have a look at the Chum formation here. There it is at location 2. So once again, top to top. So we'll draw a line here linking that together. So there we go. And bottom to bottom. So we'll link those together. Like so. Okay, so now we've correlated between those two rock layers. But you'll notice that the Wingate sandstone and the Kienta formation do not occur over here in column 1. So what's going on? Well, what we can quite clearly see is that the Kienta formation and the Wingate sandstone must be disappearing before location 1, mustn't they? What that will typically mean is the layer is pinching out. So it's becoming steadily thinner, 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 and it disappears. Okay, so somewhere between location 2 and location 1, the Wingate sandstone and the Kienta formation just became thinner and just pinched out and disappeared. So how do we show that? Well, what we're going to do is we're going to take our pencil, we're going to put it on the contact between the two layers, and we are simply going to draw a line that goes from the two layers to the point of the triangle that we formed over here. So we're going to draw a line there. So what we have here is a triangle for the Wingate sandstone, which says the right that layer is getting thinner, 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 and disappearing before 1. And here we have a triangle for the Kienta formation, which says this layer is getting thinner, 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 and then disappears before location 1 as well. All right. So all you're going to do is you're going to do this for all of the columns. So remember, you're going to join column 1 to column 2, column 2 to column 3, and column 3 to column 4. Now, a few things. Some of the formations, like the Myunkapai here, you can see it has four layers of limestone there. Over here, you can see it has one layer of limestone. So you might be asking yourself, okay, what I'll do is I will draw the top of the layer from there to there, good. I'll draw the bottom of the layer from there to there, and then I'll say this layer looks the thickest, so I'll draw link that one from there to there. No, don't do that. By all means, link top to top, bottom to bottom, because that's the correct thing to do. But you have no idea which one of these four layers turns into this layer here. And so the smart thing to do is don't try and correlate them at all. If you don't know, don't do it. Okay? Okay, so same thing goes up here with the Carmel formation. You can see we have one, two, three layers of limestone. And over here, we only have one. Once again, you have no idea which of these three layers of limestone, are going to turn into this limestone here. So don't try and draw lines of correlation between them, because you just don't know. All right? Okay. Now, in a couple of instances, for instance, some layers like this sandstone layer here are not labeled, but you can work out relatively easily that that's got to be the Dakota, whereas this red sandstone here, followed by this mudstone here, must be the Cedar Mountain formation. So occasionally the textbook decided not to label layers. I have no idea why. I guess they were feeling lazy that day. But you can work it out for yourself that this layer here is the Dakota, so that correlates to that. And these two layers here are the Cedar Mountain formation, so they'll correlate over here. All right. The other thing is that for some strange reason, they decided to label the Morrison as the base of Morrison, which is going to be this contact right here. So this is going to be the base of the Morrison formation, which goes from here to here. Okay, so now if you are dealing with the online textbook, once again, screen grabs is going to be probably going to be the way to do this. So screen grab both of these pages and then put them into something like a Word document or a PowerPoint slide, and then just draw the lines of equivalence between the layers. That's relatively easy to do. Now, if you are doing this using a hard copy of the textbook, obviously it's going to be a little tricky linking column 2 to column 3 because they're on separate pages. So the way around it is, and I'm going to be honest, it is not an easy process, is you have to hold column 2 and column 3 like so. Okay, so put a paper clip at the top here and put a paper clip down here at the bottom if you have them, just to hold the page in place, and then just draw the lines of correlation between the layers. Okay, so once again, not a particularly easy thing to do, but if you do have the physical copy and you do want to do it this way, you can do it this way, or obviously you can just scan the pages or take a photograph of the pages and dump it into something like, once again, a PowerPoint slide, and just draw the lines between the layers on that. Whatever option works best for you. Okay, so you're going to correlate between columns 1 to column 2, column 2 to column 3, and column 3 to column 4. Okay, so then we're going to have some questions that follow on from there. Okay, so question 3. So how do you account for the differences in thickness and lithology of rocks below the Chiln Formation across the region? All right, so let's have a look. So here's the Chiln Formation there. Here it is here. There. And there. Oh, if I had the page up high, sorry. There. And so you'll notice that underneath the Chiln Formation here, we have this huge, big stack. Then it gets smaller. Then it gets smaller. And then eventually, they disappear altogether. And you're onto the basement rocks. So the question obviously becomes, well, what's the possible explanation for this? Okay. Well, I would advise that there's several different explanations, to be honest, that could possibly explain this. So I can't give you too much information. But what I am going to say is, have a look at the amount of sediment. So if we look here, we have marine sediments, limestones. Then as we come here, we still have marine sediments, but you can see we've the layers are getting much thinner. Then as we come here, we've completely lost marine sediments and we have ourselves a conglomerate. And then we've completely lost the conglomerate. So maybe we're moving from a marine environment onto a continental environment. Maybe that's the explanation. Or maybe it's a question of erosion. Maybe the rocks below the Chilean Formation here have been eroded a little bit. Maybe they've been eroded quite a lot. And maybe they've been completely eroded away. And then the Chilean Formation has been deposited. So there are a few explanations, and you'll have to decide which one you think is the best explanation. So you can come up with that yourself. So question four. Which of the four sections was subjected to significant uplift and erosion during the late Paleozoic and early Triassic? So remember, late Paleozoic is going to be the Carboniferous and Permian, and the early Triassic is obviously going to be the Triassic. So let's have a look at our column here. So here we go. Late Paleozoic, Permian, early Triassic. So as we can see here, Permian, Triassic, Permian, Triassic, Permian, Triassic, Triassic. So when we have erosion in geology, we lose material. Okay, so you're going to have to work out which of the four columns has suffered the largest amount of erosion. Remember, when we have erosion, we lose material. So cite your evidence. Explain why you think that's the way it is. Okay. So the final part is question five. So how do you account for the regional differences in thickness? Now, this question, once again, is one if we were meeting in person and I could draw diagrams on the textbook, draw diagrams on the whiteboard, this would be a lot more easy to answer. But because we're dealing with a situation where we don't really have those facilities available to us, I'm going to say let's just avoid question five. Let's just not do it, okay? Because that's just going to make our lives just that smidgy little bit easier. Okay, so on to part B. So part B uses figure 6.5, which is this figure right here. So figure 6.5 is a geophysics figure. And so essentially what we're looking for is we're looking at three electric logs of wells drilled in South Arkansas through Upper Cretaceous and Tertiary beds. All right. So we're looking at three boreholes, and what's happened to these boreholes is they've tested the boreholes by using what's called spontaneous potential and resistivity. All right. Now, it's going to give you a description about these particular, a very, very brief description about these particular types of geophysics. And to be honest, if you want to know more, I would advise reading it because, you know, it's actually quite interesting what they do to the rocks to try and get this data. But we're going to just skip over that for now, because otherwise the video is going to start getting quite long. Now, if we have a look at this column on the left, okay, we can see that it's been split up for us. So you can see here we have, there's our stratigraphic column. And on this side, we have our resistivity data. And on this side, we have our spontaneous potential data. Okay, so the further out that the peak goes, the higher the resistivity or the spontaneous potential is going to be. All right. So what you'll notice is when we have rocks which are sandy, you will notice that the resistivity and the spontaneous potential tend to go down. I'm telling a lie. I'm going to shut my face there and do that the other way around. Where we have sandy layers, the spontaneous potential and resistivity go up. Sorry. Where we have limestones and mudstones, we notice the spontaneous potential and resistivity go down. All right. Now, once again, if you take a second and have a very quick read about these two techniques on Google, you'll be able to work out relatively easily why the spontaneous potential goes down for some rock types and up for others. Okay. But we're not going to worry about that. So what we're going to try and do is we're going to try and correlate this column here to this column here using just the geophysics. Okay, because as you can quite clearly see, there is no stratigraphic column in the middle here to guide us. So what we're going to try and look for are the same geophysical signals which we see in this column over here, and that's going to help us to try and work out, right, this is, you know, where these contacts are. Okay, I should point out each of these lines represents a transition from one formation to another. Okay, so how do we do it? Well, what we're going to look for is we're going to look for certain key features in the stratigraphic column. So for instance, okay, here's a really nice one. You can quite clearly see here, all right? You can have this big kick in the resistivity right there. Can we find the corresponding kick over here? Well, yes, there it is. It's a bit smaller, but it's still there. So there's our kick. Now what this means is we can see the boundary sits just below this kick. So we can mark ourselves a boundary between there and there. Okay, so we managed to link that. Okay, now what else? Well, if we have a look around, we can also see other things. Now I've actually just noticed that I think I may have made a mistake there, so I'm actually going to correct my mistake. I'm going to erase this. So the question is, well, why do I think I've made a mistake? What I just realized is that the Saratoga formation right here is picked out by this square shape in the spontaneous potential. Look over here, there's that same square shape. So the lower contact of the Saratoga was on the bottom contact of this square shape. Okay, so I'm going to link from there to there. And the upper contact was at the top of the square shape. So I'm going to link from there to there. Okay. All right, so what else can we see? Well, we can see here, we can see this big kick out, and then it steps in, and then this is the top of the ANOA. Once again, we can also see on the other side here, we have a big step out, and then it comes back in. All right, can we see the same thing? Here it is. Big step out, comes back in. On this side, steps out, comes back in. So that's going to be the base of the ANOA, however it's pronounced. I must admit, I'm not sure of the pronunciation there. All right, so we're going to come across here. So that's going to be the base. Now the top of it, you can see just before the top of it, there's this little kick out right there, tiny little kick. And then once again over here, there's that same tiny little kick right there. So just above this tiny little kick is where the upper contact is going to be. So it's going to go there, like that. So you can see we're just looking for these little indications, okay, coming from this column, coming over to this column, as to where the different formations are located. So for instance, you can see this kick out here is going to correspond probably to this kick here. Okay, this kick out here is probably going to correspond to, ooh, that one's a little more tricky, I'm going to be honest. Where's that one going to be? So if I look at it, it's probably going to be, if we look at the column, you can see we go kick, kick, kick. There's the kick, kick, kick. So the contact is probably going to be just above this one, somewhere in that area. But once again, I could be wrong. Because depending on how you analyze it, you could argue that maybe this little step out here is equal to this little step out right here. So there's occasionally you may have to use the eye of faith to try and work out where the layers are going. And so once you've worked out where the layers are on this middle column, you're then going to continue them onto the right-hand column. Okay, excuse Brownie, she was just guarding the house. So, okay, oh, and there's Rupert as well, joining in. Oh, all the dogs are going now. All right, so that's the first thing we need to do. So using the data for spontaneous potential and resistivity, we're going to join this left-hand column to the central column and the central column to the right-hand column. Okay. So that's the first thing. So we're going to correlate. So these welds are approximately 10 kilometers apart. This is an area of strong folding or tilting. So is this an area of strong faulting or tilting of sedimentary beds? How can you tell? Well, obviously, as I'm sure you guys know, when a layer of rock is laid down, it's laid down horizontally. If it's tilted, well, it's going to look like that, isn't it? It's going to have dip. So as you draw these horizons across, marking out these different formations, look and see, is there, you know, is there a lot of dip in the beds? If the beds do have dip, well, that would suggest, yes, they have been tilted. The other thing you could look for is that, do the beds go up and then do they come down, or do they come down and up? Remember, because that's what you're going to see with folding. We're going to see beds going up and down and up and down and up. Do you see anything that looks like that? If you don't see any major tilting, or if you don't see any folding, then the answer is no. The layers of rock have not been folded. Question 3. Is there evidence of thinning or wedging of beds at any particular stratigraphic level? So a thinning of the bed is when a bed gets narrower. So it will get thinner, 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 and then pinch out and disappear eventually. Wedging is the reverse. You'll see the bed get thicker over time. So when you look at your sequence, for instance, can you see the Saratoga Formation get steadily thicker, 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 and thicker? Because that would be wedging. Or do you see the Saratoga bed gets thinner, 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 thinner? So have a look out for that. See if you can spot in that. Once again, it has to be clear. Okay, if there's a couple of millimeters in it, you can't really say that's solid evidence for thinning or that's solid evidence for wedging. Okay, you would need to see nice, clear, obvious evidence in your diagram, in your correlation, should I say. Okay, so that's part B. On to part C. Now, part C is going to deal with seismic surveys. Okay, once again, text here describes the very basics of seismic surveys. I would once again strongly advise, if you have the opportunity and the time, go on Google. Google seismic surveys, find out how they're done, because once again, it's really rather cool. And that's not because my wife is standing behind me making me say that, by the way. She's a geophysicist, I should point that out. So seismic surveys essentially allow us to visualize the subsurface. They show us the layers of rock underground. So what have we got? Well, we're going to look at figure 6.7. All right, so here is figure 6.7. And you guys are going to look at this and you're going to go, what the? Because it is not a particularly pretty image, is it? But there is useful data there if you look for it. Okay, so what we're going to do is we are going to correlate the key reflecting horizons. So a reflecting horizon is a layer of rock that essentially reflects the seismic signals back to the surface strongly. So that means it's going to turn up on the seismic section as a thicker, darker line. All right. So we're going to correlate the key reflecting horizons across the seismic profile by highlighting them with a felt tip pen or colored pencils. Show faults or folds where there are evidence by offsets or flexures. Okay, now let's have a look over here. So what we're going to do is we are going to look for layers which show a very obvious and strong reflection. So here's a nice one right here. You can see you've got a nice strong reflector there. On the bottom of it, a nice strong reflector here. And we get the same thing over here. Nice strong reflector on the top, nice strong reflector on the bottom. So that's going to be the same layer of rock. And so what we're going to do is we're going to, please excuse me, need a quick drink of water. Is we're going to color in this layer of rock from here to here. I'm going to color in the same layer of rock from here to here, the same color. All right. Now please notice though, from here to here, we can't see the layer of rock, can we? It's gone. Now, we're going to explain why that is in just a second, so just please bear that in mind. Now, you could argue that maybe this layer of rock up here is the same layer, and that would be a reasonable argument. So you could claim that this layer of rock comes down here, then it suddenly goes up here, then it comes down here again. Now, if you believe that's the case, then you have to think of a mechanism that would take this layer of rock from down here and push it up to here. Okay? And so, you know, a possible mechanism could be something like folding or maybe faulting. All right? Now, you'll have to work out whether you can see evidence for either of those processes if you think it's the same layer of rock. Now, if you think it's a fault, then what you're going to do is you're going to reach across the camera, you're going to grab a ruler, and you're going to draw a line like that, okay, on your diagram. All right, now obviously you're going to draw it far more clearly than I drew it. You can't really see it. But that's going to be your fault plane, and you're going to do a corresponding line over here on this side to say that's your fault plane over there, okay? Now, in terms of other layers, you can see there are multiple reflectors coming down here, and there are multiple reflectors here. But look out for the key pairs. The key pairs are going to help you work out where you are. So, for instance, you can see we have a strong reflecting layer here and a strong reflecting layer right here, there and there. Over here on this side, we have another pair of strong reflectors. So these two here and these two here are most likely the same layer of rock. So you would color them the same color. So you'd do this layer in orange, maybe, and then orange over here, this layer in green, then this layer in green over here. All right? And so you're going to try and link up all the layers of rock that you can identify. All right? So, question two. What method of correlation did you use as you work to the problem? Okay, so review and list the methods under physical correlation at the beginning of the exercise. So, you know, that one is pre-answerable, it's in the text. Question three. What is the explanation for the poor definition of the reflecting surfaces in the center of the cross section? So, you'll notice that in the middle here, it is just a mess, and this is what's referred to as noise. There's just a whole load of noise. We completely lose any kind of clarity in the image. It's a real mess. So the question then becomes is, well, what could be causing this? Well, think about how this works. Seismic surveys need you to have heterogeneities. There need to be different layers in your sequence of rocks for this process to work. However, if you have an area that's homogeneous, well, then that's not going to work, is it? All that's going to happen is as the seismic waves come in, they're just going to get scattered all over the place. And so you're going to lose resolution and you're going to get noise. So we have to come up with a possible explanation as to why we might have some kind of heterogeneous or heterogeneous-esque material in the middle of our what is an otherwise nicely layered sequence of rocks. So what I would advise you to do is I would advise you for just a second to go to Google Earth and have a look in the Gulf of Mexico, just south of the Texas coast. And what you're going to see is on the seafloor of the Gulf of Mexico, you're going to see lots of these little circular features on the seafloor there. All right. Now, these things are commonly referred to as, I can't really tell you the answer, but I'm going to give you a hint. They have something to do with salt. All right. So have a look around, see if you can Google something to do with salt, and I'm sure you'll find the answer pretty quickly. Okay. The final question is, where is the most likely place to drill for oil in this section? Now, if you remember, if you form oil, you tend to form oil in mudstones. The oil will naturally rise, okay, and it will go into a reservoir rock, which is a porous rock, and the oil will be stopped from rising by what's called the seal. So the seal will stop the oil rising any further and keep it trapped in the reservoir. So what we want is we want to essentially find somewhere on this diagram here where oil could have risen into a reservoir rock and then be trapped by something. All I'm going to say is that salt is a very, very good seal. And so Once you've worked out what this feature in the center is, it might give you some idea about where you might want to consider drilling for oil. And that's it for exercise six. So exercise six is rather straightforward. I do appreciate it is a large exercise. And so don't be scared to contact me during office hours at the allotted day and time to ask me questions about it. And of course, I'll do my best to answer your questions in email. But of course, please bear in mind, it is a very large exercise. So if you have lots of questions, the email will be quite substantial. So just be prepared for that. Okay, everyone, have yourselves a good day and take care.